Hello, my name is Fanarelia Guerrero. I am from Nicaragua and I'm very happy to share with you my presentation on the representing Latin American repertoire, the piano music of Luis Abraham Delgadillo. In Nicaragua, the late 19th and early 20th century was a period of high artistic production. This is evident in the music composed by José de la Cruz Mena, Alejandro Vega Matus, and Luis Abraham Delgadillo. All three play an essential role in the development of Nicaraguan classical music during this period. Classical music in Nicaragua is not considered as the main element of the cultural identity in the country. This style of music was mainly adopted in the upper and middle class of society, similar to Europe and other regions of Latin America. Nicaraguan identity is folk music, predicated on indigenous oral tradition, in particular, the passing on of regional colors and rhythms in music and dance. The ensemble for Nicaraguan folk music is composed of a guitar, a marimba de arco, and the voice. The piano is not part of the typical ensemble nor a defining instrument of the Nicaraguan identity. Nonetheless, those three important composers of Nicaraguan traditional music helped the piano to stay active, being Luis Abraham Delgadillo, the most highly influential in Nicaragua and Latin America. But why is it so important to know about Luis Abraham Delgadillo? The need to study and explore many other great influential composers from the continent is also overdue. This not only allows teachers and performers to explore works beyond the standard canon, but also provide an opportunity to expose our students to lesser-known regional Latin American compositions. According to scholars, Luis Abraham Delgadillo is considered one, if not the most representative Nicaraguan musician from the late 19th and early 20th century. Even though his orchestral compositions position him as one of the most important composers from Latin America, his works for piano are also important. His catalog of his piano repertoire is vast and includes a set of 24 preludes dedicated to the memory of Chopin, 12 nocturnes, salon music such as valses and mazurkas, a sonata for piano and cello, piano trios, melodies for violin and piano, a piano sonata, and a suite for piano and orchestra. As I mentioned before, the need to learn more about Delgadillo's music is not only important for increasing Latin American representation in the world's musical canon, but specifically to highlight the cultural value of the music of Nicaragua. The purpose of my research was to rediscover and provide an overview of the composer's life and musical style, to provide a pedagogical leveling of his piano music, and the purpose of the classification and labeling of the selected works from his piano catalog is to provide detailed information and to assign a level according to James McGrath grading system, the Pianist Guide to Standard Teaching and Performance Literature, and Piano Literature for Teaching and Performance, widely recognized as the exemplar source for repertoire leveling. For the more advanced work, I use as a reference the Associate and License Diploma syllables from the Royal Conservatory of Music. These help pianists and teachers to understand the musical style of the composer, the technical challenges, and the pedagogical considerations in his piano works in order to increase his accessibility to his repertoire music. The outline of this presentation: we're gonna start first unfolding Luis Abraham Delgadillo's life, then I will discuss Delgadillo's piano music and the conclusions of the further research and the state of his sources. Delgadillo was born in Managua, capital of Nicaragua, in 1884. It is still unknown when he started his first music lessons, but there is register of his first professors. His teachers were Alberto Silva Silva, solfege and piano, Manuel Silva Guerrero, solfege and piano, and Maria Teresa Muñoz de Campari, piano, and in José Luis Medall's private school of music situated in Managua. In 1906, he has a career opportunity and he was invited to be part of a multi-act public performance for the president at the time, José Santos Zelayas. And because of this recital, resulted in Delgadillo to study music abroad. In 1907, he travels to Milan and he started his studies in the Conservatory of Milan under Paolo Delacchi, Michele Saladino, Ettore Pozzoli, and Vincenzo Appiani, with whom he refined his musical and compositional voice. In 1915, he returned for the first time to Nicaragua, and he was appointed director of the Banda de Supremos Poderos. In 1918, he was hired by the government to write a new instrumentation of the national anthem of Nicaragua, Salve a ti, Nicaragua. In 1921, he travels to Mexico, and he performed in the amphitheater of the National Preparatory School to make himself known to the artistic community and the public. In 1922, he was appointed a piano accompanist in the National Conservatory of Mexico. A few months later, Delgadillo took over the direction of the Orfeón Popular Número 5, which was a male choir. In 1925, he goes back to Nicaragua and he organized a concert at the Teatro Variedades in Managua to present to the Nicaraguan public for the first time his Sinfonía Centroamericana and his Sinfonía Mexicana. In 1926 and 1927, Delgadillo toured through South America, which included various countries such as Costa Rica, Panama, Colombia, Ecuador, Chile, Peru, Bolivia, Argentina, Brazil, and Venezuela. These trips are documented by chronicles written by Delgadillo himself. In 1930, he traveled around the U.S., and one of his biggest achievements was a lecture recital of his piano works at Carnegie Hall Chamber of Music. This was sponsored by the Consular and Diplomatic Corps of the Central American Republics. The program included mostly piano transcriptions of his symphonic works. In 1932, he returned for the second time to Nicaragua, and he started giving more recitals, and his works continued to be broadcast in different radios. He was appointed as National Musical Director by the Ministry of Public Instruction. In 1943, he travels to Panama to work at the Conservatory of Panama as a professor of harmony and piano. In 1945, the third return to Nicaragua, he was frustrated by the lack of support by the Nicaraguan government, and he kept touring around the U.S. and other countries in Latin America. In 1950, Delgadillo saw his dream come true 38 years later at the age of 66, and he was appointed director of the Escuela Nacional de Música in July 1950, and he was given the power to choose his staff. This National School of Music was officially inaugurated on October 27th by President Anastasio Somoza García. In 1951, the last 10 years of his life, the magazine Atlas Musical of Paris included the complete catalog of his musical works with their respective date of composition. He also was the founder of a permanent concert orchestra in Nicaragua, and Leo Brouwer premiered Delgadillo's Concerto for Guitar and Chamber Orchestra. In 1961, in December, there was a festive atmosphere in the house of the Delgadillo Vélez family due to the celebration of the golden wedding anniversary of Luis Abraham Delgadillo and Juanita Vélez on December 30, 1961. Delgadillo composed a musical piece entitled 50 años de armonía, 50 years of harmony, to be premiered by the Nicaragua Symphony Orchestra during the Blessing Mass at the Managua Cathedral. Soon after this, the unexpected happened. Delgadillo suffered a heart attack on December 18 and was hospitalized at the Managua General Hospital, where he was placed in a ward with an oxygen chamber. On Wednesday, December 20th, he suffered a second heart attack. On that day, at 12:10 p.m., Luis Abraham Delgadillo Rivas, at the age of 77, joined God's Divine Orchestra, as he used to say when a musician friend died. Delgadillo's piano music. I'm going to start with the 24 preludes for piano. He composed the 24 preludes for piano in 1924 as an homage to the Polish composer Frederick Chopin. They are short pieces that showcase a wide variety of piano skills. Delgadillo's preludes, as well as Chopin's, do not follow a progressive order of difficulty, but they rather include an assortment of late intermediate to advanced level pieces. Even though Delgadillo dedicated this work to Chopin, the main difference between these two sets of preludes is that Delgadillo does not follow the sequential order of tonalities found in Chopin's prelude. I did a selection of four preludes: Preludio Numero 3, Preludio Numero 1, Preludio Numero 4, and Preludio Numero 6. This just for you to show you the different level that he has in this set. Starting with Preludio Numero 3 in the level 6 or level 5 in RCM. Preludio Numero 3 is a lyrical piece in ternary form, and this romantic piece has a simple rhythmic construction and harmonic progression, which perfectly suits the simplicity of the melodic line. In this short one-page prelude, the performer will encounter some technical challenges such as balance and expressivity. As we can see here, we have that balance between accompaniment versus melody. Then we're gonna encounter in measure number 9, the melodic line is gonna be on the left hand. The performer and student also will encounter hand extension and needs to be careful with the voicing of the melodic line. Let's listen a little bit of Preludio Numero 3. Preludio Numero 1 is a slow, expressive, and melancholic piece with contrasting sections resulting from its rhythmic patterns. It is in simple binary form, and it features different changes in its texture and a wide range of dynamic changes from piano to forte. The elegance of the piece is indicated in the tempo marking Andante Amoroso. The piece starts with a steadier melancholic melodic line, later transformed into a more expressive and passionate character. As well as the previous prelude, some technical challenges are the balance, the left-hand rhythmic patterns, and artistic elements such as ritardando. The performer needs to be aware of the triplet and daughter rhythm presented in this prelude. And the execution of that left-hand arpeggiated pattern, along with the trills, needs to have a very steady tempo. Let's listen a little bit of Preludio Numero 1.
Thank you.
Preludio número 4 is one of the first fast and technically demanding pieces from the set. Although it is a short prelude in ternary form, the left-hand pattern requires advanced technique. The melodic line requires a supple and relaxed wrist to be able to perform the octaves during the entire piece. It uses a wide range of the keyboard and dynamic marks from piano to forte. The main musical elements are the integration of whole tone scales and tonic chords with the addition of scale degree 6. Musical considerations include the execution of a steady rhythm and the tone production in the arpeggiated left-hand pattern. As you can see, that left-hand arpeggiated pattern is very complex, and he added a humula effect along with the left-hand pattern in octaves. Getting close to the end of this prelude, he changed in the right-hand melodic line, and it looks more similar to what the left hand was performing before. Let's listen a little bit of Preludio número 4. Preludio número 6 is the second most demanding piece from the set. It is a romantic, challenging, and passionate composition with a lyrical melodic line written in a 3/4 time signature. This prelude is in simple ternary form with a contrasting middle section that has energetic arpeggiated and scalar passages. The dense texture throughout this prelude requires a great understanding of how to listen to the different layers and project the melodic line. The use of pedals, steady rhythm, and a wide range of dynamic marks will be part of the main piano skills required for this piece. This piece it will be closely related to Chopin's composition as it looks very similar to one of his etudes, Opus 25, number 1. He used enharmonic treatment, balance in arpeggios, and the use of Neapolitan chord resolving in A flat major, as well as the occasional use of polyrhythm. Let's listen a little bit of Preludio número 6. Delgadillo wrote the collection of 12 Nocturnos para Piano in 1907, almost 20 years before the 24 preludes. Unlike the preludes, the 12 Nocturnes are not dedicated to Chopin, but even though it's inevitable not to think of him when discussing the Nocturnes of any other composers. They are not very long, they usually are 2 pages and some of them are 3 pages. Despite this, there are very technical and artistic challenges among the 12 nocturnes. I did the selection of Nocturno número 4, Nocturno número 11, Nocturno número 6, and Nocturno número 12. Nocturno número 4 is a lyrical piece in binary form, and this short piece with a melancholic character has its melodic line in the bass, and it is played by the left hand. The rhythm is rather simple and presents mostly quarter, half, and eighth notes. An important characteristic is the use of a few instances of polyrhythm and daughter rhythms. As you can see, it has a very similar texture as preludio numero 3. In this case, the melodic line is in the left hand. He used polyrhythms and daughter rhythm in the melodic line, that the performer needs to be careful of doing it. Let's listen a little bit of nocturno numero 4. Is a peaceful and romantic piece written in a ternary form. The two contrasting sections are defined by their texture. The first section is written in a near choral texture of four voices, and the middle section with a lighter texture that will have more movement because of the rhythm changes. Some of the technical challenges in this nocturne are the balance between melody and accompaniment, voicing, and continuity of the phrase. So as you can see here, we have that polyphonic texture, and then some of the hand section in use of rotation motion will be needed at the beginning of measure 25th. Then we have again that use of 4:3 polyrhythm. Let's listen a little bit of nocturno numero 11. Is one of the longest pieces from the set. It is an expressive nocturne in ternary 4. In the first section, the melodic line will first appear in the right hand, later in the bass line played by the left hand, and finally returning as in the first section. It uses wide range of the keyboard and dynamic marks from piano to forte. As well as the previous one, artistic challenges are the balance between the melodic line and the accompaniment. You can see here the left hand rhythm pattern is gonna have more texture, and the left hand melodic line is gonna start in measure 20th. He also used hand crossing technique. Let's listen a little bit of nocturno numero 6. Thank you. Nocturno número 12 is the last piece of the set. It is the only nocturne from the set with a descriptive title, Claro de Luna sobre las nubes, Moonlight above the cloud. It is a charming and expressive nocturne with impressionistic reminiscence. This piece, similar to Nocturno number 9 that is not listed in this presentation, has different contrasting sections with different textures and technical demands. The use of big chords, octaves, double thirds, patterns, and ornaments are part of the challenges present for the performer. As you can see, the melodic line ornaments and left-hand accompaniment add that extra challenge to the performer. In measure 13, he starts adding double thirds, and the articulation and whole tone scale add more complexity to this nocturne. In measure 20, the rhythm figuration in the melodic line and the pentatonic scale add even more movement to this nocturne. Let's listen a little bit of Nocturno número 12. The Sonata Fantastica in Re Minor is undoubtedly Delgadillo's most ambitious work for piano. It is a sonata in three movements, Andante Allegro con Brio, Andante Expressivo, and Allegro Svelto. It was written in 1908 when Delgadillo was still a student in Milan. The sonata features elements that make this cohesive and unified, and even has features of a cyclical sonata. Some of these elements include the use of a daughter rhythm motif that is present in all three movements, as well as the use of an introduction in each of the movements. The sonata has a traditional three-movement form. The first movement has a dramatic and fast character. The second movement is written in a 9/8 time signature, which is slow and lyrical. And the final movement is a lively rondo that resembles a tarantella and has virtuosic passage work. The first movement is written in an unconventional sonata form. For example, the recapitulation starts with the secondary theme and never presents the primary theme in the tonic. The second movement has a lyrical and expressive character and is not as demanding as the first. But some of the artistic and technical challenges found in this movement are the use of polar rhythm, smaller passages in the left hand, and phrasing of the melody. The third and final movement has a lively and scherzo-like character that resembles a tarantella, as I mentioned before. This movement is also the longest of the three. Similar to the first movement, it presents several artistic and technical challenges, such as arpeggios in parallel motion, large jumps, voicing in the right hand, wide dynamic range, repeated chords, and fast octaves. This sonata is a virtuosic work that differs greatly from the preludes and the nocturnes. Unfortunately, today I'm not gonna be able to show you any musical excerpt of this sonata, since I still don't own the permission from the National Archive to show you this one, which I will be able to do this at the end of this year. I really wanted you to show you and to see how the sonata is written and some of those characteristics that I mentioned before. So we have the introduction in the first movement with that daughter rhythm. And that's gonna appear in the second and the third movement that I will show you in a little bit. Then immediately after that introduction, we're gonna have our first theme in the and with a left hand alberti bass and that melodic line. As I mentioned, some of the challenges are gonna be the left hand and right hand arpeggiated technique, going always to a cadence, and those chromatic passages that we're gonna find in the middle of the movement. In the second movement, we have again that introduction with a louder rhythm. And this is gonna follow to the main movement theme with a left hand accompaniment in which the phrasing of the main theme is gonna be a little bit challenging, which we need to avoid some accents in between of this phrasing. The left hand rhythmic figuration then start getting more complex as well as the right hand. As you can see here, it's gonna have more movement and more big chords. The third movement, as I mentioned, it was the longest with 457 measures and is in a rondo form. Here we have again that introductory theme with a daughter rhythm, and then we're gonna find that tarantella style. As you can appreciate in measure 17. Here we need to be careful with the left hand accompaniment pattern versus the right hand rhythm. And here is gonna be under the performer decision how to perform this rhythm if it's gonna be doing it that daughter rhythm, or you're gonna be playing this along with the last eighth note of the triplet. Starting in the middle of this movement, the left hand accompaniment pattern start getting more and more complex as well as the right hand, and then ends in a very more peaceful way in the same way as the first movement. So in the further research that I have, it's an updated edition of his piano catalog with fingering markings and pedal indications, as well as pedagogical and critical annotations, which can make them accessible for pianists and wanting to explore the music of Delgadillo. I am in the process of the recording of his piano works, and this was a starting point to further research and study other Nicaraguan composers that have written piano work, specifically salon music, as I mentioned at the beginning of this presentation. The state of resources are extremely limited to public access since there's only one published collection of a small selection of piano works from 1955, and those are the 24 preludes for piano and the nocturne for pianos, some of voice and piano music, as well as the violin melodies with piano. The Archivo General de la Nación, the Instituto Nacional de Cultura, and the Instituto de Historia de Nicaragua y Centroamérica, the last being part of the Universidad Centroamericana, are the only institutions in charge of his manuscripts, but neither institution provides these documents in the digital format. For instance, you need to travel to Nicaragua in order to see this. I hope you like this presentation, and I hope you will contact me later to request the music of this wonderful composer. Thank you so much, and if you have questions, please send me an email, and even you can contact me either in Instagram or Facebook, and I will try to help you and guide you the best I can. Thank you so much.